Hey guys, it's Tamara. Thank you so much for coming back to my channel. Welcome. Today we're going to be talking a little bit more about the ACE study, and I want to bring up another study that's just as important as the ACE scale. You guys had a lot of awesome questions about my video on Monday, so I figured we would talk about this just a little bit more today on Wednesday as a bonus video. And I think that it's going to be important for us to understand the flip side of the ACE, which is the topic of resilience, right? We need to talk about that as well, because not only are we looking to educate ourselves about trauma, we're also here on this channel to educate ourselves about ways to bounce back and to cope with the negative things that has happened in our lives. So this video is going to be a kickstart to that, because on Friday, I'm going to be talking a little bit more about natural remedies and coping skills. All right. So thank you so much for coming back to my channel. For those who are subscribed and for those who are new to the channel, I encourage you to hit the subscribe button over here so that you can stick around with us as we learn and grow, and you can suggest topics to me and really become a part of our community. I would love to have you. The benefits for you in today's video is that you're going to be learning about the resilience questionnaire, which is kind of like a sibling to the ACE questionnaire. And I also want to talk about the four factors that's associated with resilience. So let's just go ahead and jump in, all right? So on Monday, I talked about the ACE questionnaire, which is the Adverse Childhood Experiences Scale. And all you do with that scale, it's in the video that I'm going to post up here for you, actually. It's in the video that I did on Monday. And you can watch, go back and watch that. But you can also get the ACE scale in the description box so that you can answer all the questions for yourself. So that you can see what your ACE score is. Someone told me and left a message in the comments section that they had a score of 5. Somebody else emailed me and said they had a score of 10. Oh my goodness. And then somebody else also sent me an email stating that they had a score of 1. So scores can really range depending on what the challenges are that you have had growing up and how you define them and interpret them. Now, what you'll notice about the ACE is that it's very easy, right? You add the numbers and then you tally up your score. But it's a little bit hard to determine, well, what does this actually mean? So I told the person who scored a 5 in the comment section that the higher the score, the more likely you are to struggle with risk factors, right? So the more likely you are to struggle with chronic illness, the more likely you are to struggle with unprotected, unplanned pregnancies, the more you're going to struggle with other things like drug and alcohol addiction and mental illness and impulse control issues. Okay, so the higher the score, the worse your struggle. The lower your score, the better chances you have to approach things in life from a better and more healthy perspective. Okay, so the ACE questionnaire really does give us a measure of how many negative and traumatic situations you've dealt with and how you're going to manage them or balance them or deal with them. Okay, so I do like the ACE study, and I think it's a really easy way to give yourself a total score so that you can evaluate, where am I on this thing, right? Am I more vulnerable or am I less vulnerable? Okay, so that's the ACE score. Now I want to introduce to you the resilience questionnaire, and that questionnaire is a 14 question form, and what it's looking for are protective factors. Remember I talked about risk and protective factors. I want to put that video up here for you. Risk factors are things that make us more vulnerable to life, right? It makes us more vulnerable to challenges and trauma, whereas protective factors are things that protect us from the risk factors, right? So good schools and good grades and two-parent household and higher income and parents are not on drugs or having challenges with alcoholism, right? You have a support system, you have a broader worldview. So all of those protective factors really do guard against those risk factors, okay? So those are protective factors. So the resilience questionnaire, it's really trying to target those things. How many protective factors have you had? Okay. Now, there are four factors associated with resilience. And so let's just go ahead and talk about that a little bit. All right. So the first factor that's associated with resilience is the ability to make plans, to set plans, to set goals and achieve them, right? That's the number one factor associated with resiliency is the ability to set plans in stone, to plan things and to achieve them, okay? So follow through, accountability, right? The ability to organize something and achieve it, all right? So that's factor number one. Factor number two is confidence and self-efficacy. Confidence and high self-efficacy or positive self-efficacy, okay? You have to have confidence in order to achieve. And if you have a sense of high self-efficacy, right, or positive self-efficacy, the ability to look at yourself and say, okay, I can do this, right? Self-assurance is another way to look at this. Then you're more likely going to achieve your goals, okay? You're more likely going to achieve your goals. You have to have confidence. You have to have high levels of self-efficacy, and you have to be able to set things in stone and achieve it, okay? So let me give you an example of this. So let's say in your childhood, you had some exposure to trauma. You dealt with post-traumatic stress disorder. You went to counseling. You were able to develop appropriate coping skills. You scored a 4 or a 5 on the ACE score or the ACE test questionnaire. And here you are trying to develop the appropriate coping skills as an adult, and your clinician gives you the resiliency questionnaire. Let's say on that questionnaire, you have a bunch, at least 13 resiliency numbers that you tallied up. You scored great. Everything is wonderful, right? Let's say that, you know, you have struggled with flashbacks and depression and anxiety, but you've always found a way to cope with it. You have the confidence to go back to therapy and to do some extra work. You have the confidence to set the goal that I want to go to therapy, develop more coping skills, I want to develop more skills, and I want to do well at counseling so I can come out on the other side. Let's say you achieve that, right? You have a high level of self-efficacy, you have self-determination, you've set a goal, and you've achieved a goal. The goal is to go back to therapy, learn coping skills, and overcome some things and leave. You've done that, right? All of that is based on your resilience. The other part of that is based on your high level of self-efficacy, right? Your confidence that you can do it. Without confidence, you're going to shy away from therapy. You might flounder in therapy. You may say, you know what, this is not working. I'm out of here, right? So having a high level of confidence and self-efficacy is what's going to get you to the finish line. And that's what the resiliency questionnaire is looking for. All right, number three is having communication and problem-solving skills. If you have poor communication or you have some kind of altered communication because of drugs or alcohol, or you have a personality disorder that gets in the way of appropriate communication like sociopathy or psychopathy or borderline personality, you're very emotional, it's going to be really hard for you to communicate your needs and your wants appropriately, right? If you also don't have the ability to problem solve, then you're going to get yourself into a lot of situations where you can't get out, okay? So communication skills are extremely important. Let's say you took the ACE scale, you scored an 8 out of 10, you were exposed to a lot of trauma, you're angry, you're hurting, you never got mental health treatment or counseling, you grew up in a malnutritioned, malnourished household or environment. Your mom and dad were never really around. You raised yourself, right? You were raped, molested. You saw a lot of violence, right? A lot of crime, a lot of drug activity. Let's say all these things have happened to you. Now you're an adult and you've scored an eight on the ACE scale. Your life is a mess right now, right? You've got two fathers that are, you've got three children who have two different fathers, right? Right? So two of your kids have two different fathers is what I'm trying to say. Or the reverse, right? You're a dad to a variety of kids because you utilized sexual experiences or intimacy to kind of fill the void, right? Or let's say you have a drug and alcohol problem because drugs kind of helped you get through your pain. Alcohol numbed the pain for a little bit, right? It took your pain that was way up here and brought it down. So let's say that this is what is happening. So now you're trying to carry a job, carry a relationship, and keep your family communication positive. Well, you don't have that ability, right? Because you've had a very tough and a very rough and a very challenging lifestyle. So let's say that this is what's going on. So how did you learn to communicate? Well, you learned to communicate via anger, raising your voice, slamming things, throwing things, kicking things, engaging in property destruction. You've learned that if you threaten and bully, you will get your way. You've learned that if you manipulate, you can keep people wrapped around your finger long enough to use them, right? You've learned that if you manipulate using communication skills, sex appeal, emotional things, whatever, that you can get over on people and you can get your way. So you kind of develop maladaptive communication skills, and you don't have the ability to problem solve. When you don't have those very important things, the ability to communicate and the ability to problem solve, you end up in jail. You end up raped, assaulted physically, emotionally, psychologically, right? Or you may end up in another terrible situation where you can't reverse it, death, right? Some individuals end up in gangs. Other people end up in cults, right? So this is very important, right? The ability to communicate and the ability to have problem-solving skills is utopia. And if you don't have that, then your resiliency goes down, right? You don't have the ability to bounce back, all right? And last but not least, the fourth factor that's associated with resiliency is the ability to control emotions and impulses. Remember, I talked about in this video up here, the brain, and I'm going to come back and talk about the electrochemical process of the brain and why resiliency is important, but we're going to get to that, all right? We might talk about that next Friday, but for right now, I want you to think on your ability to control your emotions and to control your impulses. Can you do that? Can you not do that? If you can't do that, then your ability to bounce back from situations is really difficult, right? So, you know, this is a resiliency factor, the ability to control how you're feeling and to really check yourself and pump the brakes before you react. Without that ability, it's going to be really hard to undo damage that you've caused. It's also going to be really difficult for you to have healthy relationships. So these are very important factors, guys, and that's why they're called the four factors associated with resiliency. I'm actually going to do another thing for you guys, and I want you to go ahead and take this scale and see where you're at. I'm going to post the resiliency questionnaire in the description box below, and I'll post the link to the website as well if I can find it so that you can go back and take this and see where you're at. You want to keep the A score, and you want to keep the resiliency score. And as a matter of fact, you can actually take both of these scales and questionnaires into a therapist or take it into your PCP and ask them, hey, do you understand these scores? And, you know, can you add this to my health record if it's going to help you guys understand me? So thank you so much for being in this video today, guys. I encourage you to give it a thumbs up if it was helpful to you. And I'm going to actually come back next Friday. We're going to talk about the electrochemical process of the brain and why resiliency is something that has a lot to do with what happens in the brain at very young ages. We're going to continue these conversations, guys. Next Monday and next Wednesday, we're going to jump onto another topic, but I do want to end this focus next Friday be talking about the electrochemical process, so stay tuned for that. I will see you guys really soon. Bye-bye.